Americans moaned about the massive influx of immigrants from Europe, who were fleeing political and religious persecution and hoped for a more prosperous life elsewhere.
About 60 million people left Europe to go to different continents between Waterloo and the outbreak of the Great War. That's an enormous number, especially when you compare it with the size of the population of the time. You know, it's not clear that we've ever gone back to as liberal a regime as we had at various points in the late 19th century.
In huge flows of people from Germany, England to the US, largely because they were very highly skilled workers and Americans were prepared to pay a premium for their skills. No one objected to these people coming into the US in a significant way.
Stephen King is an economist and author of the book Grave New World.
The Irish potato famine, which was happening again in the mid-19th century, is a slightly different story. Desperate people made the move across the Atlantic in so-called coffin ships because only about 80% of those who made the voyage actually survived the voyage itself. By the end of the 19th century, you had people coming to the US from China, from Southern Europe, from Eastern Europe, and so on.
And so the composition of the flow is changing in terms of the ethnic origins of these people, in terms of their religion. You're getting more Catholics, you're getting more Jews from Eastern Europe, and that, of course, is going to then give rise to a backlash against immigration. You have a series of anti-Asian exclusion acts, for example. Eventually, what you have in 1917 is the passage of the Literacy Act, which is going to bar a lot of poorer people. That's partly fueled by cultural animosity against, you know, Catholics and Jews and so on coming in from Europe, partly fueled by racial prejudice. So there's all of that stuff going on as well, but are also in part driven by income distribution.
Then, as now, people worried that immigrants were competing with native workers for jobs and forcing down their wages.
Unlike the case with the European agricultural interests, the incomes of American workers aren't falling in absolute terms. I mean, this is a period of growth and their wages are rising, but they're rising by less than they would have done had there not been immigration from Europe, and their relative position within the American economy is declining.
So is there a sense in which globalization can only go so far before it creates a reaction, that it's not a surprise that we get these sort of tides in history of increased globalization and then a reaction?
I think that's a reasonable suggestion. The scale of the globalization of the late 19th century, I think, is what gave rise to these political backlashes. And I think similarly, the scale of what's happened over the past, say, 20 years in our own time is also what's given rise to the political reaction. Now, then the question is, can you do anything about it? You know, if I were Mr. Davos or Ms. Davos, I think I might at this stage be saying to myself, well, maybe we want to consolidate what we have rather than keeping the train always going forward. The second thing I'd say is that if you want to have more markets internationally, that does involve gains, but it also exposes people to risks. And if you look at the early 20th century, what you observe is that the very early beginnings of what eventually is going to develop into the European welfare state are being developed precisely in those countries in Europe that were most exposed to globalization. First of all, you have the development of, say, factory inspection acts to regulate the workplace to make it less dangerous for workers. And then you also have the development of social insurance. You have accident insurance, unemployment insurance. In some cases, you even have old age insurance, pensions. It's something that happens actually pretty broadly across the developed world at that time. And as I say, it's notable that where those social welfare protections were put in place earliest, it tended to be where governments found it easier to maintain openness as it came under challenge in the last decades of the century.
So you can have globalization if you compensate the losers. Is that the argument?
Well, I don't think that you can have an ongoing process of ever deeper international integration if you don't worry about the losers at all.
Globalization came to a juddering halt in 1914 with the start of the First World War. Migration stopped, and the two sides tried to restrict the trade of their enemies. What nobody expected was that it would be 60 years or so before global trade reached the levels seen before the war.
have already.
After 1918, the world order changed. Britain was on the winning side, but the war had exhausted its resources. The country was no longer the superpower it had been during the 19th century, and that made it a lot harder to get global trade and finance flowing again.
There had to be a conductor of the international orchestra.
Barry Eichengreen is professor of economics at the University of California, Berkeley, an author of Golden Fetters.
Going out for a meal, going to the cinema, shopping, those kinds of things comprise a much larger share of our economy than they do for most of our European comparator countries. So in a situation where you've literally shut down all those industries for almost 3 months, a long period of time, it is unfortunately going to have an outsized impact on our economy.
When you look at the numbers that we've just seen, you know, 20.4% in terms of the fall in GDP, was that just a price worth paying for keeping the disease under control?
I think we took the decisions that we did at the time we did in order to protect people's lives and suppress the spread of the virus. And those were the right decisions. But it's also now right, given the progress we've made, to have safely reopened our economy. It's not a sustainable situation to have vast swathes of our economy essentially shut down, and that's why we have been able to successfully reopen bits and do it in a safe way. And as people get back to going shopping or going out for a meal or indeed getting back to their office, they will see that it's a new normal, it's a safe normal. We have made changes, guidance is there to ensure that safety.
And they shouldn't be too nervous about the virus, should they?
No, I think as people will see as they go out, whether it's to a shop, whether it's to a restaurant, whether it indeed is back to their office, I think they will see changes, and those changes are quite tangible, and people should take confidence from those changes to know that this is now a new, safer environment for me to go and do all those things. And that's good news. I think we need to get the economy going. We've talked about jobs earlier in this interview, and we want to try and protect as many jobs as possible. That comes from as much of our economy returning to normal as possible, and that's why we're so focused on these things.
Well, in just a moment, we'll speak to our political correspondent, Kate McCann. First, though, to our economics editor, Ed Conway, who you saw speaking to the Chancellor there. Ed, give us a bit more information about the numbers, but also, did you get the sense that there is a plan forming to try and get out of this?
Well, as the Chancellor was pointing out, these are clearly very unprecedented numbers. You know, we've never seen a contraction of the economy that's been anything like as deep as what we're going through at the moment. And most of that is bad news, but there is actually a bit of good news about how unusual this is. But it's worth just, first of all, looking at the scale of what we're talking about. And if we just can show you a chart of GDP going back over the course of the last few quarters, and you can see there an extraordinary fall in economic activity. And remember, what we're talking about here is the amount of income we're generating across the economy that's just divided between all of us. So this really does matter. This is the sum total of everything that is bought and sold in this country, and it's gone down enormously. And that won't come as a surprise given the nature of the lockdown, but nonetheless, it is striking to see. And if you compare the UK with other countries around the world, you get a similar picture as well. It's a bigger fall in the UK. There you can see the red bar there. A bigger fall in the UK than almost any other country, apart from Spain, which had a similarly intense lockdown and a similar spate of the disease around the same kind of time. But bigger in the UK in terms of the contraction than in France, in Italy, in Germany, or indeed in the US. And there are other countries in the G7 which have yet to report their numbers, for instance, Japan and Canada. But the expectation is they will be a smaller contraction than we've seen in the UK. But as I say, this is striking. These numbers are certainly unprecedented. They aren't necessarily a surprise, though, and many economists thought there was going to be a very deep contraction, perhaps even deeper than what we've seen in the event. And there's two pieces of good news, perhaps, to cling to. The first is that there is a bit of a bounce back that we're seeing if you delve into those numbers and look at the numbers specifically for June, up by about 8.7% in that month. That means the economy is getting back to where it was before the crisis, but it's still a very long way short of where it was, about 17 and a bit percent short of where it was. But the second bit of good news is, obviously, this is unlike any other recession in terms of the scale, but it's unlike it in terms of the nature. This wasn't just a recession that came from elsewhere that was thrust upon the government. The government helped impose this recession with the lockdown. That was part of the answer to trying to deal with COVID-19 as far as the government's concerned. And their point is, now the lockdown's been eased, we should see a quick bounce back. And indeed, this could well be the shortest recession in British history. It may also turn out to be the deepest.
Interesting. Ed, thank you. Let's speak to Kate McCann, who's in Westminster. Kate, as Ed was outlining, not a surprise to any of us, but what has the reaction been from across political parties?
Well, as Ed was just saying there, the government did effectively impose this themselves with those lockdown measures, and they will be clinging to the hope that they can rise out of this recession quickly, that the economy will start to get moving again, and that they can move forward, because we're already starting to see Labour's attack lines and how they plan to go forward here. It's being called Boris Johnson's jobs recession. There's lots of concern about unemployment. Annalise Stoss, the shadow chancellor, says there's the worst death rate and now the worst recession across developed nations. Now, that's something that the Conservatives really will not want to stick, because they've made their reputation, as we all know, on fiscal reliability, responsibility, and particularly over the last sort of 10 years or so, actually the employment rate. So this impending unemployment crisis, which may well come to fruition later this year, will be something that is really concerning those in the Treasury. Couple that with the potential of a second peak of this virus, and things might get really tricky for Rishi Sunak, the Chancellor. There are, as Ed said, some bright spots, the potential that the economy is starting to recover. Lots of money and lots of initiatives have been pumped out by the Treasury, including Rishi Sunak's Eat Out to Help Out scheme, which is costing millions and millions of pounds. But it certainly won't be the end of it, and there are still questions about the furlough scheme, about whether some of those jobs may well be lost anyway when it comes to the end of its run. So some big questions for the government, and the Conservatives will be hoping that they can ensure the country does bounce back quickly, because if they can't, this will form the basis for Labour's attacks for many, many years to come.
Kate, thanks for now. At 11:30 here on Sky News, we're going to have a special report on the impact of the pandemic on poverty and unemployment. Sky's Tom Parmenter has spent time with a charity in Manchester, working with some of the families who can least afford the effects of the COVID-19 crisis. So stay with us for that later on. GCSE and A-level students in England will now be able to use mock exam results as their final results this year to progress to university, college courses or employment. In a late intervention by the government, students can now either use the moderated grades given to them by the exam boards, their mock exam grades, or resit the exams in the autumn. This move comes after the Scottish government reversed its decision to downgrade more than 120,000 moderated results. Inzamam Rashid tells us more.
For A-level students in England, a lifeline from the government.
Big relief, because I did really well in my mocks. I got 3 A's.
A lot of stress kind of went off my shoulders immediately.
It gives you another option, in a sense. It gives you more of a sense of confidence.
Tomorrow, thousands up and down the country will find out their results in what has been an unusual and difficult year. But it all comes down to an algorithm calculating results for them. In Scotland, it's failed, downgrading 125,000 results. It's forced their government to replace them with original scores. In England, the government is now offering a way out. Students will be able to keep their grades from mock exams if they are higher than the calculated ones, and they will have the option to resit exams in the autumn if they're unhappy with their mock exam results or their grades tomorrow. Jesse, Yaya and Leo are all waiting for their results.
Whether they're worse, they're better, I've got grades that I'm proud of anyway. And so it's a big sense of relief for me that I will hopefully be going to the uni of my choice regardless.
I'm much more satisfied because I feel that before, when they said it was just based on the calculated grade, we didn't have much of an option if we did fail or if we did have to go through clearing or if we did get bad grades. Because it seemed like if an appeal had to go through, it had to go through with the school, and we know how long that sort of process would take. So I think referring back to your own piece of work is definitely, it definitely gives a student more of an option. It definitely gives us more like relief, I think.
This 11th hour change to the system will come as a relief to many, but students like Leo say there are still concerns.
I'm just more confused. I think before I was angry because I thought that this system was unfair and it was a broken system. But now I'm just confused because I just don't think mock grades are the right way to go because they're not standardised. So that means there's going to be so many inter-school differences.
For many, these results will play a vital role in university and job prospects, and this triple lock from the government does give students options. But it's come late, and it's still unclear how this new measure will be implemented fairly across the country. Inzamam Rashid, Sky News.
Let's speak to our political correspondent, Tamara Cohen. Tamara, as we heard in the report, they're a very late call by the Education Secretary to do this. They saw what happened in Scotland, but there's still a bit of a rocky road ahead here.
Tom, yes, really unprecedented, with just 36 hours to go until A-level students receive their results, to see a change of this magnitude. And it follows, of course, the huge backlash we saw in Scotland against the way that the results were calculated, which was seen as leaving disadvantaged students worse off than those from the more advantaged groups. Essentially, what Gavin Williamson has said overnight is that no student should feel that they are being treated unfairly. So as well as the way it is already being calculated, which is teachers submitting grades and those being what's called standardised, changed a bit depending on how their school has done in the past, they will not only be able to appeal through their school or indeed by actually sitting the exam later in the autumn if they choose to, but they can also appeal if they got a higher mark in the mock exams that many schools took earlier this year. Now, the message we got from the schools minister, Nick Gibb, this morning is that he doesn't expect this to make a huge amount of difference to lots of pupils. This is what he told us.
This is just to capture, to give a safety net for any student who might fall through the system. That's the purpose of the announcement today. It will only affect a small group of people. Most young people tomorrow will get the grade that the teacher sent into the exam board that they thought they would get. Those grades that are being changed, they'll only be being changed by about one grade.
Now, teaching unions have reacted quite angrily, with the ASCL union, which represents head teachers, saying it beggars belief because teachers have spent weeks devising these grades and now they could be out the window, when actually mock exams, not only have a lot of schools not done mock exams, but they're not marked in any standardised way, so it could be quite hit and miss. Now, there are no real easy answers in this unprecedented year in which pupils have not actually taken physical exams, but the message from Department for Education officials this morning is they are not going to have a U-turn as in Scotland. They are not just going to use the results that teachers have calculated, but there's no doubt that that now leaves a double standard between England and Scotland in which the grades are being calculated in different ways, and many say this is just unfairness of a different kind. But the government, desperate to head off a rebellion on this, hope that this is going to be a way to try and keep most teachers, pupils and parents happy.
We shall see. Tamara, thank you. Let's take a look at some of the morning's other main news for you. The Metropolitan Police have defended officers after a car carrying the Labour MP Dawn Butler was stopped and footage of the incident spread online. Deputy Commissioner Sir Steve House said the officers had acted properly and it was unfair that they should be subjected to trial by social media. Joe Biden has named California Senator Kamala Harris as his running mate for the presidential race. Senator Harris is the first black woman to compete on a major party's presidential ticket, and Mr. Biden described her as a fearless fighter for the little guy. But in his White House daily briefing, President Donald Trump reacted to that decision by calling Senator Harris phony and nasty. Australia has suffered its deadliest day yet in the fight against COVID-19. The state of Victoria reported 21 deaths from the virus and 410 new cases. Melbourne, the state capital, remains under severe lockdown restrictions, including a night curfew. Meanwhile, New Zealand has deferred the dissolution of Parliament because of a number of new COVID cases in the country. It was due to take place ahead of the country's election, but has been put off until Monday. The government has also closed all aged care facilities as a precaution. The media tycoon Jimmy Lai, owner of Hong Kong's Apple Daily newspaper, and pro-democracy activist Agnes Chow have been released on bail after they were arrested as part of a crackdown under the new national security law imposed by Beijing. Chow was arrested on charges of inciting secession and Jimmy Lai for collusion with foreign forces. Get more reaction now to the main news this morning that the UK has entered the deepest recession on record after the economy plunged by more than 20%. between April and June. I'm pleased to say that we can be joined now from Staffordshire by John Caudwell, founder of Phones for You. John, good to speak to you. Thanks for taking the time to do so today. You, I think, forecasted around a 15% drop, so worse than even you thought.
No. I forecast up to 15% drop for the year. What we're seeing now is 20% for the quarter, which is actually slightly better news than I forecast. At the moment, now it looks like an annual GDP drop of somewhere around the 10%, but I think it'll...
you and signpost you to the right governmental departments. You can reach us on 033 01 332415 or email us at info@emmacares.org. Confidentiality is key. Thank you.
Tune in to On Point here on Star Radio UK with Empress Regina every Monday at 5 p.m. GMT. Looking forward to your company.
Check me out.
He tells me my energy is making him tired.
Yes!
How do you get the energy to do that?
I've been told that I have a lot of energy, but my goodness, I think today I have met my match, people. I have met my match, Miss Suzanne. Wow, amazing.
One of the things that's the start of the
darkness.
Whole of darkness.
So what did that
myself and the world in adjust? And 2019,
forget the proverbial boardroom. Join me, Simone Frazier, on The CEO, the program that gives you the driving seat over your life every Tuesday, 8 p.m. only on Star Radio.
Hi everyone, it's your girl BB Clement, the author of How to Go From Employee to Entrepreneur and the host of your weekly business show, BB Means Business, the show where we discuss everything you ever wanted to know about business but you were afraid to ask. How do I start my business? How do I raise the finance? How do I grow my business? Where am I going to find my customers? Join me every Tuesday at 1:30 p.m. on Star Radio UK to get all the information and tips that you need to become a successful entrepreneur and become financially free. Remember, don't let life dictate to you. Rather, put your signature on life.
Hi there, this is CJ Buckman, your life coach. And whenever I'm in London, I listen to Star Radio UK right here. But guess what? You can listen to wherever you are.
Broadcasting worldwide, online 24/7.
All around the world.
In your car.
At work.
At home.
On your smartphone.
This is Star Radio UK.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Smile though your heart is aching. Smile even though it's breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you get by. If you smile through your fear and sorrow, smile and maybe tomorrow, you find that life is still worthwhile. If you just smile.
Hey, this is Archie and you're listening to Star Radio UK and the Morning Show.
Good morning and welcome to Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. And I want to welcome you all to the greatest program in the whole wide world, the Star Radio UK Morning Show. Of course, I am Archie. Today is the 12th day of August, the year 2020. The time now, 10:37 from the hearts of London. But of course, it is the Wednesday edition of the morning show. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good dawn to you wherever you are. And once again, thank you very much for tuning in to listen to us on Star Radio UK. Share the broadcast with your friends and loved ones if you're on Facebook, Twitter, Periscope, and all the others. But on Facebook, invite your friends to like our pages as well. But as I say all the time, the best way to listen to us is via our apps. Go to the App Store, download it for free. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel. Straight and say good morning to my colleague and co-presenter Mr. Frank Davis on an errand this morning. Mr. Olaide Kwaeke will be joining me exactly at 11 o'clock. Felix all the way in Aberdeen, good morning to you. Ebenezer Hammond in Cape Town, South Africa, massive good morning. And to all of you wonderful people who have tuned in this morning, found the time, tuned in this morning to listen to us. Of course, wherever you are, whether in your car or whatever.
In your car,
at work,
at home,
on your smartphone.
A massive morning also goes to Dr. Morton. Thank you for the message, the news there as well. To Mr. David Kluche, wherever you are, good morning, Big Dave. And then to Felix. I mean, Captain Felix Sette. Kwame Charlie Tete, massive good morning to you all. So, if it's the first time of you listening to us on Star Radio UK, this is how the program is going to be going. I bring you the culture today, the weather forecast will follow suit, the travel updates. Bring you some of the news making the rounds. 11 o'clock, we have Mr. Olaide Kwaeke joining in to bring you updates from Nigeria. 11:30, we open the lines. 12 o'clock exactly, we bring the program to a close. We'll take you straight to the Scottish Parliament. Okay, and some other presentations that government will be doing here in England as well. But wherever you are, don't go away. It is Star Radio UK. 10:40 the time, and let me crack on with it. Says to be truly independent is to be free of others' ideas of who you should be. That is a good one. And let me reiterate. Now, to be truly independent is to be free of others' ideas of who you should be. So don't let anybody tell you who you should be. Who are you yourself? I know people will try to mold you into something that this is how they want it to be. Oh, this is the cap that they put on you. You can rise to this height. But I want you to debunk that and know that even the skies cannot contain you. So get on. Find yourself, discover yourself, and rise to your highest peak. Start Radio UK. Now let's move on straight to the weather front. Let me tell you what is happening on the weather front. I tell you, for the couple of, how many days now I've not been sleeping? It's all due to the heat that is we are experiencing here in the south of England. I know those of you in the north, Scotland and all that bit, you are still chilling out nicely. Alright, so this afternoon will be hot and humid with hazy sunshine. However, a patchy cloud will bubble up with a risk of catching a sharp shower or thunderstorm in the afternoon. Light winds expected as well. Now this evening, any thunderstorms will tend to fade to leave it largely dry with clear spells and patchy mist overnight. However, later there is a risk of further storms moving in from the south. Total temperature is going to be 34 degrees, the lower is going to be 20 degrees. Pollen level is going to be high, pollution is going to be moderate, and then UV level is going to be high as well. Sunset is going to be at 20:28, and sunrise for tomorrow morning 05:42. That brings us to the end of the weather forecast. Let's take a quick break and I'll bring you the travel update. Stay tuned, don't go away.
Hello lovely listeners, tune in to the renewed show with Charlotte. Make it a date to listen to me this and every Thursday at 5 p.m. on Star Radio UK. Tune in to an hour of power, an hour of encouragement, an hour to inspire you to stay positive and strong in this season. See you there and listen. Check it out.
Go any further, let me say a massive good morning to Jonas Jonico Kobila. Thank you very much for joining us on the Facebook broadcast as well. Share the page with your friends and loved ones, as I said earlier on, and invite them to like our pages. Now keep your eyes on the roads. It's already UK travel update. I can't see where every weekday from 10:40. It's not 10:44 though. Now, on the underground this morning, apart from the Waterloo and City lines, all the others have got good service. TFL Rail has got minor delays. London Trambling, good service. London Overground, good service there as well. DLR, good service. Now, on the riverbank this morning, RB1, XRB2, RB4, RB5 are all suspended. That aside, all the others, good service. Keep your eyes on the roads. I will keep you navigated. I promise I'll bond the Star Radio UK travel update. I can't wait every weekday from 10:40. Now, moving on to the National Rail this morning. Avanti West Coast has got minor delays. East Midlands Railways, minor delays. First Transpennine Express, minor delays. London North Eastern Railway, severe delays. Northern Rail, Special Service, Scott Rail, severe delays. Southeastern, severe delays. Southern, minor delays. And Thameslink, minor delays there as well. But check before you leave so you don't find yourself missing your appointment or anything of the sort. But continue to keep your eyes on the roads. Let's move on to the final sector of the travel update. And that is the major roads in London. On the major roads in London, A10 has got closures, A3 closures, A4 closures, A40 closures, Central London Red Roads closures, North Circular A406 closures, South Circular A205 closures there as well. And as I say all the time, well, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good dawn to you, wherever you might be on planet Earth. Enjoy your commute for today, but you know what? Continue to keep those eyes on the roads.
This is your friend Uruj from SendWave. SendWave is a money transfer app that is used by people all over the world to send money to their loved ones in Africa. With SendWave, you can send money to Ghana, Nigeria, Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. And the best part is, SendWave is absolutely commission-free. Our exchange rates are excellent. You can see for yourself by checking them out on our website. So how do you use SendWave? SendWave is an app that you can download onto your phone from the App Store or Google Play Store. The app is free to download. After downloading it, just open the app and enter your name, email, and phone number. That's it. You're good to go. Make sure you use the promo code SR. S for star, R for radio. This promo code will give you £5 free credit to send to Africa on your first transaction. Your money will be delivered to your recipient within seconds. Feel free to call me on 0749-7377-647 at any time. I'll be happy to tell you all about SendWave and help you in any way I can. Remember to use the promo code SR for £5 free credit. Medase.
Lovely listeners, tune in to The Renewed Show with Charlotte. Make it a date to listen to me this and every Thursday at 5 p.m. on Star Radio UK. Tune in to an hour of power, an hour of encouragement, an hour to inspire you to stay positive and strong in this season. See you there and listen.
Getting onto the property ladder has never been easy until now. Join us this and every Thursday from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. live on the Property Hour show on Star Radio UK, where we talk to mortgage brokers, property developers, estate agents, landlord, tenant, property consultants on how to invest or get into the property business and make money. You can't afford to miss this. The Property Hour show is your best source into the property industry.
Hello, good people. I'm back again, and this time it's about Mama's Choice Fufu Mix. It comes in two flavors and it contains essential minerals and vitamins. It's gluten-free. You can grab one from the nearest Afro-Caribbean shop or the corner shop next to you. Insist it's Mama's Choice. It's certified by both the US and the UK Food Standard Boards. Grab one for yourself today. Mama's Choice. Bedisa Charlie.
You are listening to Star Radio Morning Show.
Welcome back to the program. It is Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. In the next 11 minutes, we'll be having Mr. Olaimi Kweki, who'll be joining us to bring you updates from Nigeria. So wherever you are, don't go away. Continue to share the broadcast with your friends and loved ones. Let me acknowledge a couple of people who have joined us on the Facebook transmission. Joma Cisse, Cyrus Johnson, Amanda Peggy Stevens, and George T. Marshall Jr. Wherever you are, good morning to you. It's lovely to have you joining in. Glenn Tala, Paul Propler, and Samuel B. Jacobs, I salute you all. And thank you very much for joining us on the Facebook transmission as well. I know as many of you are watching us on our apps, and those of you on the YouTube channel and all the other channels that we are using this morning. But wherever you are, it is Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. Now, moving on to the story that is making the rounds this morning. Let's look at some of the stories that is making the rounds this morning. Now, in the UK front, let me start it from here, okay? Quick one from there, and then we can move on. Like I said earlier, on exactly at 11 o'clock, we'll have Mr. Olaimi Kweki, who'll be joining in to bring you updates from Nigeria, okay? Now, so in the UK front, UK in recession for the first time in 11 years. 11 years for the first time. The UK has officially fallen into recession after suffering its biggest slump on record between April and June, and A-level students get triple lock on their grades. Last minute changes have been made to the way A-level and GCSE results in England are to be decided. Now, more pupils return as Scottish school reopens. These are some of the stories making the rounds. And Kara, who went untested, fears she spread COVID-19. Whoops. Okay, and then Met condemned social media trial over MP car stop. Now, we live in a world where everything and anything that you are doing, you could put it on the social media platform, and hey, Everybody will be there, either championing or lambasting you, anything of the sort. Now, you can you remember Don Butler was pulled over by police while traveling through Hackney and she filmed the encounter, and because that found its way onto the social media platform, we've had the police saying that well guys, don't be doing that to us. You don't condemn us on social media platform, but this is the world that we live in now. So anything that goes wrong, people put it there, and people have their own opinions about it, and that's exactly what seemed to be happening there. A senior Met official has condemned the trial by social media faced by officers who stopped a car carrying a Labour MP. The former shadow Equalities Minister Don Butler accused the force of racial profiling after their stop on Sunday. Now, she shared footage of the incident on her Twitter account, which has spread widely on social media. Deputy Commissioner Sir Steve House defended the officers who he said acted professionally and politely. He said, while officers expected to be scrutinized, they are existing appropriate and proportionate process for complaints. Sir Steve said the increasingly routine trial by social media is unfair and damaging to individual officers and has the potential to undermine the role our communities need us to do to protect them and keep them safe from violence. Well, it is interesting. Somebody asked, so if you are driving now and the police stops you, is there anything wrong with it? It depends on how the approach is done and how, of course, at times there are racial profiling, because you see that this is a black guy driving that car, pursue. But I remember the police, I'm giving an explanation that, well, the one who imputed the registration of the car, which they really wanted to stop, put in the wrong reg, and it happened that was the car in which Don Butler was traveling in. Okay, Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. Bring you some of the headlines before we move on. Now, Joe Biden has picked Kamala Harris as his running mate. My apologies. The senator is the first black woman and South Asian American to be a vice presidential candidate. Now, would that boost the fortunes of Joe Biden and the Democrats? Yeah, we'll be having a look at those stories. Maybe if she had taken a Caucasian person, maybe they could have brought it together. Or because, well, let me leave my case there. I wouldn't make any alternative, but I want to know what you are thinking about this choice of running mate. I mean, if you remember, presidential candidate debate that went on, the primaries, you remember the I won't call it confrontation, but the exchanges that went on between both of them. Now, what do you think about that? Do you think it's a match made from heaven and that will boost the fortunes of the Democrats or Joe Biden as a president? I want to know more about that. It is Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. Now, Beirut has held a vigil to mourn explosion victims. A Muslim call to prayer is broadcast and church bells toll a week after the devastating blast. Okay. And it's a very, very sad one. Like we said the other time, if you have any ways of supporting them, please do so. It's very, very trying time for them. Two Iranians have been sentenced to 10 years for spying. One man was accused of being a UK spy, while the other was convicted of spying for Israel and Germany. Okay. Now, interestingly, we had Russia yesterday saying that they've come out with a vaccine for COVID-19. Ooh, I'm proud to say. But interestingly, the scientists are saying that, well, they think that they've rushed into it. They said they've tested it, and the president said that he's tested it on the daughter and all that stuff. Let's see what is going to happen on that front. Maybe it's a good one, but we have to wait for about a month. Those that have tested, have tried it, they've been tried on with that vaccine. Let's see whether it's going to work for them. If it does work for them, why not? But it's going to be a competition. You look at how they actually came out with the publicity and stuff like that. They were doing it as if when there was a race to go to space during the Cold War, and then the Russians managed to go there first. However, the Americans came in and they took a next step to get on the first person to walk on the moon. Okay, so they did that as well. So maybe now the US are also looking at it, and we have the UK, who long time ago have said that we've come out with that, but we are doing clinical tests and stuff like that. Well, let's see what happens from there. A vaccine discovery will be good for each and every one of us. Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. Now, deadly Indian clashes over post on Prophet Muhammad. Now, yesterday we did talk about a sentencing of a singer in Nigeria who had been sentenced to hanging and due to blasphemous statement, comments or lyrics that he used in composing the song. So he's going to be we don't know what's going to be happening on that front though, because we are expecting the federal government to step into it. But so far, as far as we know, this gentleman has been sentenced to death by hanging. Okay, so what is happening in India as well? Now, one day I think I will have to have the scholars, the Islamic scholars, and have some other faith scholars also coming in, and then we have a debate, we have a chat on this. Now, if I believe that God is very strong, I believe that Jesus is powerful, I believe that. Now, do I have to be fighting for him? Somebody will say, yes, that's why in the past we had all these crusaders they were trying to fight for. We know that the ulterior motive wasn't that they had to overcome, to empower themselves and to overpower people who were, practicing these particular religions. But what do you think about all that? We have to have a chat about this, so that when I say something, some people, they swear, they say things about Jesus, other faiths, Buddha, this, that, but nobody does anything. So how come that when somebody says anything about the prophet, then people get upset and they end up beating people, killing people, sentencing people to death and all that stuff? What do you think about all that? Okay, Star Radio UK. All right. Now, moving on to some other stories making the rounds in or on the African continent as well. Before we take our break, I think our break, I need to take the break virtually about now, but don't go away. Don't go away. First Ebola, then COVID-19. How Ebola prepared one doctor in the Democratic Republic of Congo to treat coronavirus. Now, we need to take a leaf from his book. Maybe he's got a way of treating that because of the way he treated the Ebola. Now, Chad leader named Field Marshal for fighting jihadists. President Idris Deby honored with the highest military rank in the country during Independence Day celebrations. Okay. Now, has he actually brought the jihadists under control there? That is another question that we need to be following suit. But it is Star Radio UK. Let's take a quick break. 11 o'clock. Whilst we wait for Ms. Olaemi Koki to join us. But let me bring you this song. It is from Koda. I know that this morning, maybe I'm going to be going through some tough times. Challenging times. No explanation enough can make people understand what you are going through. However, I know somebody who can help you. So, Made Away by Koda. Enjoy it, and I'll be with you. from Koda. Make a way. Right, it's Star Radio UK at the time now. 5 minutes past 11. No food on my table. Don't know how, but you did it. Meaning I've got my main man, Mr. Olaemeko Eke, who has joined in. So let me go straight to Mr. Olaemeko Eke and let's see whether we can hear him this morning. Yomi, good morning to you.
Good morning back to you in the studio, Mr. Archie. Good morning, Frank, and good morning to all the other presenters. I say very good morning to all our viewers from around the globe that have also joined us on different platforms. And we say welcome again to the morning show, where we're going to be bringing you some of the latest news back in Nigeria and some of the development news taking place with the Nigerian community back here in the United Kingdom as well. I will now hand over back again to you in the studio.
Yes. So how are you doing this morning?
Well, as you can see, the weather is still very, very warm. And I'm sure this is the time of the year that we consume quite a lot of water due to the weather as well. I can see, we are still kind of, finding out things gradually in terms of, the environment, especially with the coronavirus that has also taken a lot of impact on not just the community across. I am doing very well as usual. And like I said all the time, the longer you are alive, the more that is hope for things to happen. Yes, a very beautiful view from behind me. And I will now hand over back again to you in the studio.
Yes, listeners, Mr. Olaemeko Eke, bringing you updates from Nigeria. But before we go on, let me acknowledge a couple of people and then we go on from there. Zawu, good morning to you. Jimmy Fayi, Ahmed Keita, Mohammed Kongbi Kroma, Kitty Grace Sion, Amelia Wallace, Patrick Pehe Manjoy the second, and Selassie Samuels, wherever you are, good morning to you all, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, now let's go back to Mr. Olaemeko Eke. Yomi, so what's happening in Nigeria today?
Well, there's normally a lot of things that is happening, but one thing we always try to do is that we follow the news as it's happening. And also, I can confirm that yesterday we were looking into, the video that we played yesterday. There's information that, the gentleman also spoke again this morning, but I'm also aware that he has now been called by the DSS, and I'm sure all that will be taking place in the next an hour. We'll be following that development of that story, but there has been a lot of outcry in regard to that particular video that we did also play yesterday. And also, let's just quickly look at what is trending on Twitter, because Twitter tends to be where a lot of Nigerians engage, whether Nigerians at home or Nigerians outside the country as well. So what I'm going to be looking at quickly is the first 5 tweets that is happening currently. Our challenge as fellow Nigerians is not to defeat our enemies, but to defeat the enmity we have for each other in our hearts. Unity we stand, divided we fall. I am sure a lot of people might disagree with that, but again, everybody's opinion is something that we cannot go back to. Many Nigerians killed in Southern Kaduna genocide. I have also been using the word genocide because the more people are killed that are for because of their tribe, their ethnicity, their religion, automatically, according to the United Nations, that is literally a genocide that is taking place. I'm also going to be looking at another one that says, Happy International Youth Day, all hardworking Nigerians youth, doing all their best and chasing their entrepreneurial dreams. The future is bright. There's a place for you ahead. Well, whether the future is bright is another question that we can question, because a lot of people will say the future is not bright because there's not hope for so many people as well. I will now go back to some of the other headlines as we have it this morning coming out of Nigeria. Once again, this is Star Radio UK, your finest African and Caribbean radio station in London. Yesterday we talked about the musician in Kano that has been put onto the death sentence. Outrage continues to grade the death sentence on the Kano musician for blaspheming as well. Also, like I did mention earlier, the DSS have now invited Dr. Obadiah for accusing government of sponsoring Boko Haram. That is a very serious allegation. And again, this is something that we must continue to review based on some of those things that he said. Let us go back to some of what he said. We said that also during this pandemic lockdown, a lot of aircraft were moving, not just money, they were also moving weapons, and likewise, they were moving all kind of other, you know, materials, which we don't know what they're going to be using for. He also blamed that one of the leaders of the Boko Haram is someone from the north part of the country that is also a governor. Whether a current governor or a past governor, I will not be able to say. But according to the Department for State Service, has now invited a former deputy governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria, Dr. Obadiah Malafia, to his just office. Malafia confirmed the development to one of the correspondents, and I also received that memo that he sent out as well. He said, yes, it is true. The DSS invite me to appear in their just office by today noon. I will be following that as well. Malafia said his invitation was not unconnected to an interview he granted on an Abuja radio station on Monday. And again, in an interview, he said, repentant terrorists told him that a serving northern governor was the Boko Haram leader. I think you might want to touch on that if I come back to you in the studio.
Yes, interesting, interesting. Yesterday, after the program, I didn't listen to the whole interview again. And I'm like, really? But if he, then that means that he has some details or some information that will be of use to the DSS. And we are hoping that they will actually investigate it. But if, because, I mean, I know time and time and over, Frank has also alluded that, look, there are some big hooks behind the whole thing. Because how can they have planes to fly weapons from one point to the other, as this man is alluding, money from one point to the other, and we know where they are, but they are saying that the military are saying that we can't get to them. So I seem to agree with what he is saying, if there is evidence of truth. And thank God he's not
live on the radio.
Yeah, live on the radio as well. And thank God he's not dead,
live on the radio.
Out of the country. So definitely let him give the information, and let's see, let the government come out to say that they are debunking what he has said.
Well, like I said, I will follow that development. It's not the first time that the individuals have been kind of linked, you know, with the Boko Haram. Mm. But this particular person coming out to tell the world that some individuals within the north of the governorship are also the leader of the Boko Haram, and likewise, like you said, so many people have also listened to that same video, and that is creating a lot of tension within the community, back home and outside as well. Let us touch on some of the other news headline as we have it this morning. Once again, this is Star Radio UK, the finest African and Caribbean radio station in London. No money was deposited into the account of the pastor linked to MAGO. That also is another headline that is coming. Nigerians' hate speech fine rises fear of licensed intimidation of dissent. That is also coming up as part of the update as well. Likewise, INEC to conduct 6 senatorial by-elections and others on the 31st of October this year. Nigerian Trade Office target 50% share in the GDP by 2023. Court convict pirate involving hijack of a vessel navy. Insecurity, Buhari governor seek joint strategy to end the conflict. Let's touch into that story a little bit further. According to the president, Buhari and the state governors on Tuesday yesterday ended their meeting on the state of the nation security with a call for a joint strategy to bring in various conflicts to an end within the time limit. We've heard about this for the last 6 years. Continuation of the killings of not just innocent Nigerians, but also dispersed them as refugees in their country. And if I go back to this Twitter handle saying, the Nigerians have turned Sunnyside into their refugee camp, and now Sunnyside smell like Addis Ababa. Hashtag open refugee camp. We now know that so many people, for their negligence of the government that have not put things in place,
Okay, listeners, bear with us. I think Mr. Laimi Koyeke's line is suffering a bit of
a lot of people as a
yes, Yomi.
I've kept a lot of people into the abject poverty as we know it today. Let's touch more on some of the other headlines, and I'll come back straight to you in the studio. Once again, this is Star Radio UK, your finest African and Caribbean radio station in London. as we continue, we can also tell you that the COP wants INEC to adjust the timetable for the Ondo State and the Edo poll as well. Also, five takeaways from the virtual colloquium on the continuous COVID-19 measures. COVID-19 is still a big threat in the country. And like I also say, Nigerian coronavirus now have surpassed 47,000. Let's take more into that story. According to the report yesterday, 423 people have been added to the number, 47,000 in total. The number of the cases in the Nigerian crossed 46,000 as of Saturday. Nigeria continues to report less than 500 daily coronavirus. And likewise, despite the continued decline in the daily figure of the confirmed coronavirus infection, there has been troubling uptick in the mysterious cases that health experts believe would upset plans of the full opening of public activities across the country. I know the last time you did ask whether we could find out, you know, in terms of how many tests has been done. But what I can confirm is that to see if I can find that figure here, what I know is the mega city of over 21 million is the hardest hit, which is Lagos State, with about a third of Nigerian cases, over 16,000 in Lagos alone, recorded in the country's commercial capital. The second most affected places in Nigeria is Abuja, where we have about 4,500 cases as well. Nigeria has only tested, which I have right with me now, 320,000 out of the country 200 million population. Star Radio UK, I'll hand over back again to you now in the studio.
Yes, listeners, it is Star Radio UK. The Wednesday edition of the morning show with Mr. Olaemi Koike, we're bringing you live updates from Nigeria. Okay, now let's touch on that refugee situation that you did talk about, where people are talking about that some part of the country has tend to be like that of Ethiopia, where there is refugee situation because of drought and fighting that seem to be going on. Now, what has caused these individuals or these people to move from their communities? We know that Boko Haram has been one of the issues, and we know that government is saying, oh, we seem to be addressing that issue. The other time, we did touch on a story where soldiers who are in those communities, who have gone to, protect these individuals or to fight Boko Haram, has taken over the lands and the properties of these people and maybe are embarking on farming and stuff like that. Is that what is happening that has caused these people to be displaced from their homes?
Well, what we know is that, for years, of negligence of the government and the continuous attack of the same terrorist group, Boko Haram, has displaced a lot of people from their community. Villages have been burnt down. People have also, been left inside of different, IDP camps across the country. This has become a big issue that has become, humanity is under suppress as well. Boko Haram goes into villages, kills as many people, and the people that are able to be surviving it fly away from those communities and sometimes find themselves in the IDP camp. And like we know, sometimes the same IDP camp are also being attacked continuously as well.
Wow. We hope that the government sees to address this issue. Are they living in tents? Are they being given food, water? Are they being supplied with all those things? Do you know?
Well, most of them are living on kind of handout, by the support of individuals and sometimes the government as well. But what we've also seen is that in the past, the food men for the IDP are also diverted as well. So, and most time, lack of the basic amenities, the welfare of those living in that community, in the IDP, are not being taken care of. And if we remember, about a few weeks back, we had a UN helicopter that was taken down. These are part of humanitarian effort to support those in the IDP. But sometimes, again, like five workers were also killed some few weeks back. Again, it has become a big problem for those trying to help and likewise those that have been affected as well.
Wow. Listeners, Star Radio UK, Mr. Olaemi Koike in North London, bringing you updates from Nigeria. I'm actually here in the studios. Let me acknowledge a couple of people and then we'll go back to Yomi for some more stories. Now, T. Edwin Taylor, wherever you are, good morning. Jackson W. Propler, Vani Kone, Linden Kone, Mamadi Sako, Boema Johnson, Moiki Peter Sech Tule, SDJ, wherever you are, good morning to you, and thank you very much for joining us as well. Let me go back to Mr. Olaemi Koike. Yomi.
Well, the pressure in terms of the forex, the foreign exchange, is becoming very, very quite alarming. As at yesterday, the pound to naira was 590 on the black market, and that means, you know, the pressure in terms of the goods and the services at home will become something that you know, we must continue to look and review as well. That will then take me into, you know, the business part of the news this morning, where we continue to review. According to some of the headline, the Nova Bank wants to partner in financing Nigeria's economy recovery. According to Mr. Duhura, said the bank was looking at prospect of creating medium to long-term loans with tenure ranging between 3 to 5 years for industries like agriculture, telecom, and healthcare, where clear opportunity exists to tap in. Most times, you know, it is good to think in that direction, but sometimes the money does not get to the right people for some of this sector, as we know. Also, the Maritime Agency are planning 24 hours operation in the Nigerian port. Nigerian port has become one port that has not just have impact to those that are trying to send goods outside and those receiving as well. What we do know is, you know, the congestion in that area, the corruption that takes place as well, but we are now getting the message to say the Maritime Agency plan 24 hours operation in the Nigerian port as well. The Nigerian stock market index dropped further from 0 to 58%, and likewise, I'll take one more, and this again relates to the electricity. Electricity is one of the biggest threats when it comes to the power of those in Nigeria. A lot of people are running businesses on their generator. A lot of people are wondering why for 60 years we've been in darkness without a quality power supply. According to the ex-PHCN workers entitled to 4% of the privatized electricity firms, a former workers of the defunct Power Holding Company of Nigeria are to be allotted 4% of the federal government equity holding in the successor power company. The Bureau of Public Enterprise disclosed this on Monday. According to the privatization agency, made this known in a statement in Abuja to announce the payment of about 409 billion naira as severance and debt benefit to affected ex-workers. And we hope the money will not become something that will come back and it will fizzle out away from those that really need the money. Let's touch a little bit into the health sector as well. Most African countries have been badly affected with coronavirus, and the same thing as well in Nigeria. According to the World Breastfeeding Week, COVID-19 pandemic orders dominate the health story this week. The world is still battling the coronavirus pandemic, which has infected over 19 million people and have also caused about at least 728,000 deaths globally. According to Nigeria, has now recorded 46,000 cases of the virus, with over 942 people have died. Although the pandemic has overshadowed other health issues across the world, the World Breastfeeding Week was commemorated during the week. Here is a roundup of some of the health stories which has made headline in Nigeria. Nigerian coronavirus has exceeded 46,000, and likewise, the risk of COVID-19 infection through breastfeeding if care is not taken as well. Exclusive breastfeeding, according to the National Health Insurance Authority bill to incorporate exclusive breastfeeding into the act. According to the lawmaker, said this will help create an enabling environment for exclusive breastfeeding and the child nutrition in the country. And I hope it is easy to, you know, to put the act of law where a mother has to breastfeed, but also it will be good to also indicate the welfare of that child from the government as well. I will now hand over back again to you in the studio.
Yes, listeners, Mr. Laimi Koike for you from North London, bringing you updates from Nigeria. And let me acknowledge Bukola Ibrahim. Thank you very much for joining us as well. She says, good afternoon. That means that where you are, it's afternoon now. We are in the UK. It's still morning here. It's 11:24 from the hearts of London. Now, let me ask you a quick one. You were talking about the exchange rate where the Naira seemed to be losing its value. We know that because of the pandemic, countries are seeing their currencies just tumbling down. A few of them have tried to, put systems and things in place to make it a bit robust. Now, I know that Nigeria looked at, as the president, when he came into power, looked at the rice, importation of rice, and thinking that, well, we have to consume homegrown ones, and therefore, I mean, stopped rice importation from coming in. And we know that most of the times, the foreign currency that we use in importing stuff is one that actually puts our money. If we are doing more of that, it brings our currency, the value of our currency down. So, has the rice importation stopped? Commenced? Have they allowed people to do that, especially with the COVID-19 and everything, people not going out and lots that have happened? What has happened to that thing that was going on there?
Well, in terms of the importation of rice, that has completely been banned. So that means you cannot bring rice into the country. It's one produce that is not allowed into the country. Yes, you know, in terms of the homegrown, the government says they're doing a lot in terms of, you know, supporting the farmers, in terms of the fertilizer. But one thing again is, you know, the border that has also been closed from the Benin Republic coming into the country is having a big impact, you know, because the government believes that, you know, that has been used. Remember, we talked about it, you know, where, you know, food is allowed within the, you know, the African, you know, ECOWAS community countries. But people have been repackaging some of those rice and bringing them through, you know, into the country as well. Whether in terms of enough of homegrown rice across the country, we are still far behind in terms of that, you know, the production of rice growing in the country. A lot of the problem that people also have is, you know, the sorting out of some of this rice. You know, they're very good. I eat them. I have one that is called the Ofada rice. But again, you know, back home, if care is not taken, most of them are not well sorted out. And that is the reason why people believe that a foreign rice is the best option as well. But we must also remember that, you know, when people cannot get into the farm, then, you know, the production of that same rice is something that we must continue to review. For so long, you know, the herdsmen have clashed with the farmers. Farmers are not enabling to go back into the farm. But I can confirm as of yesterday, the Amotekun that we've talked about, Ondo State, have literally now confirmed a full launch of it yesterday, with a lot of images coming out from Ondo State. And we hope they'll be working around the clock to protect, you know, not just the boundary, protecting the farmers as well in the state and maybe close to the border as well. Let us touch more on quickly on some of the other, you know, in regarding what you've just mentioned as well. But we must also understand that if we don't have the enabling environment, there is no way a farmer will be able to produce more, and that means the hunger will continue to be there. Yes, it might be an advantage for the diaspora to send the money home, and it gives them equivalent of about 590 to about 1 naira. And if you're doing it officially, it's about 490. But the problem is that is creating a lot of pressure for those at home, because job loss is there, the economy is already in inflation, and all these are part of the reason why, you know, a lot of people are saying, including myself, and this is my own opinion, that the only option we have on the table now is, let us break Nigeria, let us all go into our own regional, you know, country, self-determination, where we can produce and we can do so much. And I could say also that there will be a rally, a peaceful rally across the globe that will be taking place on the 1st of October that we will continue to talk about. I know it's a Wednesday, we need to go into the Prime Minister question time. Yeah. But later on Nigeria Voices, we will continue to review more on that video of Dr. Obadifia regarding some of the messages coming out of it. It needs a lot of scrutiny, because some of what he said is so much that we need to review for a very long time.
Interesting. Let me acknowledge a few people before I hand over Mr. Lai Mikoiki goes. Now, Lauren Simon, Adrian Billing, Robert Jones, Tijan K. Fatih, Mamadou Bedman Barry, Basiru and Jaban Jame, Cynthia Odoi, Ashley Maru Weiss, Vivaldo Neto, Omo Osuma, wherever you are, good morning to you, and thank you very much for joining us. Yomi.
Well, likewise from this end, I would like to say good morning to, you know, Mrs. Abby Williams watching us as well, and also all the way from France, we have Peter Obadoni, we have Abiyo, we have Nisma, and everyone that is watching us, Babatunde Oladada, and those that have been part of the Star Radio UK, join me later on as well at 1800 hours, where we continue to review that same video that is already trending on the social media, and we might be finding out more whether this individual will be detained or will be allowed to go during the questioning with the DSS in the next half an hour from the information that we gathered.
Yomi, Let me say thank you very much for that wonderful update. Have a lovely day, and we catch up later.
Star Radio UK, continue to enjoy the program, and I'll be back again later on at 1800 hours for the Niger Voices. Bye from here.
Bye bye. Well, listeners, that was Mr. Olaemi Koike bringing you updates from Nigeria. It is now gone 11:30. We take a quick music break and we come back. And you know what? The lines are opened as well. With the discussions that have gone on, things that he's talked about, you want to share your take on some of the issues, feel free to do so. The lines will be open for you to do so. It is Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London.
After seeing all was one in Africa.
Morning show, the Wednesday edition of the morning show, of course. So in the next 26 minutes, I'll be bringing proceedings to a close. So wherever you are, just continue to stay tuned and listen to us. But that music is from Rasky Mono, the late Rasky Mono, Under Pressure. Okay, so you want to call in, you want to share your take with us on any of the issues that have been discussed this morning, call us on 0208133 2257 or 58 0208133 2257 or 58. If you are in US or Canada, it is 001-718-303-2737. 001-718-303-2737. You can text or WhatsApp. It's 075-3966-1744. 075-3966-1744. Our Twitter handle is at Star Radio UK. Email address is info@starradiouk.com. Thank you very much once again for tuning in. Continue to share the broadcast with your friends and loved ones as well. Okay. Now, moving on to some of the stories making the rounds this morning, as I said earlier on. In Ghana, 2020 polls, NDC needs over 30% Ashanti votes to win. That's what Ben Efsen, the pollster, is saying. We'll bring you more details of that. And how feasible is that for the NDC? Can they do that? Can they garner any up to 30% of the Ashanti regional votes? And if they do so, how and what will happen from there? And Domake Osekufuado has lost control of MPP. That's what the former president Mahama is saying. GES reversed exam ban on 13 students after Kufuado's intervention. Okay, whilst we're discussing that, I think was it Monday? I remember my colleague Frank saying that, well, he doesn't think that we have to, just because of maybe some mistakes that some people are doing, or so we just throw them under the bus and just leave them and just ruin their future, but we should give them the opportunity. Well, I think that fine, opportunity has been given to them, that but they should be punished for that. They should find another means of punishing them so that it becomes a deterrent to others, so others don't behave that way. It's not just saying, oh, okay, it is all right, so now let's leave them to be. But what I would think is, what I'm thinking is that we need to punish them, so others will know that they don't have to go that way as well. Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. And as I touched earlier on, UK, in the UK, UK is in recession for first time in 11 years. And I know most of us listening, those who are tuning in this morning, will be talking about that. But I've got my colleague, my brother Felix, who has joined in. Let me go straight to him and let's hear him. Let me see whether he can hear us. Felix, good morning to you.
Good morning. Can I make a snappy?
Yes. Go on.
Right, okay. Why do you think the case should be punished? What have they done wrong?
Now, they didn't study, or because of the passcode that was given to them for them to go and study, and they went to study that and it failed to happen. We don't want it to be a trend where people can just go on like that. We know that the education ministry decided to suspend them from writing the exams. However, I'm of the view that if they are allowed, fine, the president petitioned that they should be allowed to do it. But if they are just left off, then what is going to happen is next time some people can also do that. And what are we going to do to those others then?
Okay. I understand that there were some who went around and destroyed school property.
Yeah.
Right. So if those people have to be punished, I understand that.
Okay.
Right, okay, for the destruction of school property, because the communal assets, you don't own it.
Yeah.
It's not a private property that you can set it ablaze if it's your own private property. In some cases, even you can't set your own private property ablaze because it could be charged with us.
Yeah.
But other than that, it's difficult for me to understand why they should be punished. If they are speaking ill of the president, so what? Is that a crime?
Oh, okay. Those who spoke ill of the president, that one I don't think is a crime. They shouldn't be, because we have freedom of expression. So if they have said whatever, they might have some justification for saying that. So find out from them.
If they were pouring libation, so what? Is the libation not a prayer for traditionalists?
Uh-huh.
Is it wrong for traditionalists to pray? For those who say they were calling curses and so on and so forth, those who go to church, Mm-hmm. When they go and read their Old Testament, do they not see some of the prayers that King David?
David prayed.
Yes, prayed in Psalms. Have they not seen that? Well, sometimes they even called
on you know, to strike them.
Yes. Even on generations yet unborn.
Yeah.
You know, I can't quote specific verses to you, but if you go and read, you'll find them there. Curses were called upon generations yet unborn. You know, fetuses that have not even come into existence yet. They've been cursed. It's not only people. Something the prayers were said so that their land could become barren.
Barren.
Now, what is the crime here? I mean, look, we as a state, we ask these children to go back into school, to go and be infected with a virus that we have no cure for.
Yeah.
Some even lost their lives. They didn't get the day, first day of examination. We put them through that. We've even stopped their parents from visiting them.
Yeah.
They can't even see their parents. They don't know whether grandma they left at home is still in good health or not. We have imposed all of these things on them. And they say one or two things that are not pleasant to your hearing, and you are banning them from writing exams. To the best of my knowledge, unless they've, you know, been engaged in examination or practice.
Yeah.
I see no reason why they should be stopped from writing the exam. I understand that you write the exam as a student of a particular school, and therefore, if you face disciplinary action, which results in you being dismissed from the school or being suspended from the school, then you cannot write the exam anymore because you are not there in your own private capacity as an individual, as it is in the case of NOVDEC exams. But when you are writing the May, June exams, you are writing the exam as a student of a particular school. In effect, you are not there solely as an individual. But having said that, if they speak ill of elders, so what? See, for many years, we've been told that we should respect elders. But truth of the matter is that respect has to be earned.
Of course, of course.
And if our elders today, our elders of today, you know, be they Supreme Court justices who are telling us that our birth certificate is useless, yet most of them, their children and grandchildren, hold birth certificates of other countries, and therefore qualify to be citizens of other countries plus citizens of Ghana, yet you are telling them that they, for them, their birth certificates are useless. If you send them into, effectively, a zone for them to go and contract diseases without any way of finding a cure for these things, and now they are bad-mouthing you, why should they be punished?
I get you.
I mean, can you imagine during our time, somebody said, telling us that we should go back to our boarding schools in the northern part of Ghana where you have cerebral spinal meningitis. Because we have to go and write exams, or because we have to go and put our name on the voters register to vote for somebody. I mean, what would you... you being forced to go back to school when you know that there's an outbreak of CSM.
Yeah.
With the potential of losing your life. I mean, I think we are being unfair to these guys. And by the way, who gave them the impression that PASCO is going to come anyway? Was it not the same grown-ups?
Yeah. It was the grown-ups. Yeah.
What's the big deal there? You know, because you are wrecking their future. In some cases, you wrecked their future. Because not everybody who will get the opportunity to receive these exams and do well again.
Because, as you know,
the grades that will get you into a certain school this year, those same grades next year won't get you into school.
Yeah.
And even if it does, it probably won't get you the same course to go and read. So we have given them a bad deal. We forced them into schools. We've asked them to have minimum contact time with teachers. We've given them red, gold, green, violet, indigo, whatever.
Traffic lights.
Yes. On top of that, we've even forced them and exposed them to diseases that they otherwise maybe they wouldn't be exposed to. And now they give you 2-3 seconds of bad mapping on social media and you are annoyed. And by the way, those elders who are saying that they should be punished for them to learn a lesson from them, what is their conduct themselves in public?
Well, it's better when it's on the other food. When it's on your food, then that's.
Oh
bad.
Yeah,
that's
okay. Well, they should they should learn from their own conduct. You know, we have given them a bad deal. Remember, this is a generation that is going to come and inherit huge amount of national debt.
Yeah.
You know, huge amount of national debt. It's not like we are leaving for them something fantastic. It's not like a child being born in Norway, where you have a huge pension pot waiting for you, in excess of, you know, per capita, in excess of $100,000 per every Norwegian. We are not leaving them with much. We are polluting the waters that they drink.
Drinking from.
We are selling off national assets, and we are not even leaving anything behind. We are messing up their educational system. We are now exposing them to diseases without cure. We are messing up their educational system. They have very less contact hours. And we are saying they give us maybe 5, 10, 15 seconds of bad mouthing on social media, and we are vexed. What's the problem? We are happy to throw all sort of punches at them, but when they throw one back, we are vexed.
Children obey your parents. That's it.
Well, like Peter Tosh said, if you live in a glass house, don't throw stones.
Of course.
Have a good day.
Have a good day, sir. All right, man. Bye-bye. Well, listeners, that was Felix from Aberdeen bringing his take on some of the issues that we are touching on this morning. It is the Wednesday edition of the morning show, meaning that it's going to be ending exactly in the next 40 minutes. If you also want to add your voice to the discussion, feel free to do so. Add your voice. Come in and add your voice. Okay. Now, replacement A-level grades no lower than mock exams. A-level and GCSE students in England are being promised that their final results will be no lower than their mock exams. So that is a problem. Some of the kids did not actually bother about the mock because they were, oh, it's a mock, just get on with it. We know that the main exams was going to come, and then they decided not to maybe consider it or do it very well. I remember back in the day when we were writing our GCO level, the mock that we did, I think we were just playing about or something. So if based on that, they had used that. Okay, even that, yeah. A few of the people, I mean, got in the English and the maths. I mean, a few of the people had problems with it because they didn't take their time to actually do it because, you know, it's a mock, or let's just get on with it. They're going to study for the main thing, and some even didn't come to write it at all. Okay, so looking at such incidents, and then looking at the fact that even here, some of our kids were not paying attention in class, knowing that, well, the final exam is the one that is going to decide on their future. What do you think should be done to them? Do you agree with what they are saying, that they should be marked per their mock exams? Now, the Department of Education announced a triple lock, so results will be the highest out of their estimated grades, their mocks, and an optional written exam in the autumn. So there's going to be an optional one. So maybe if you don't do well, if you're a parent and you are listening to us, your word doesn't do well, that is what you might have to try to encourage them to go and write, so that they don't just throw their future and say that, oh yeah, that's out of the window, saying that, well, we don't want to know. Head teachers attacked their last minute change as panicked and chaotic. The change means that if pupils get an estimated grade lower than their mock exam, they can appeal. But this will have to be through their schools, with the terms for approving appeals to be decided by the exam watchdog Ofcom. Now, Geoff Barton, leader of the ASCL Head Teachers Union, said the move beggars belief, and that mock exams were carried out in many different ways and were not consistent enough to be used to determine A-level and GCSE results. The government doesn't appear to understand how mock exams work. They aren't a set of exams which all conform to the same standards. The clue is in the name, mock, said Mr. Barton. Now, Universities UK says it is seeking urgent clarification about what it will mean for university admissions. So actually, maybe after all is said and done, and things have returned to normal, would you take those students who graduated from secondary schools to sixth forms, and then from sixth form to universities during the year 2020, would you take them like, well, these are people who actually learned and wrote their exams, cracked their brains. Are we going to take them like that, or it's going to be one of those things, well, these are people who that, let's just push them through, and we just push them through. What do you think about all that? Star Radio UK, 11 minutes to the top of the hour, the time, the morning show. Of course, I am RJ. Now, moving on to some other stories, straight to the U.S. Now, Biden, Vice President Pick Kamala Harris, chosen as running mate. Now, Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden has named Kamala Harris as his running mate, the first black woman and South Asian American in the role. Now, once a rival for the top job, the California senator of Indian Jamaican heritage had long been considered the front runner for the number two slot. The former Californian attorney general has been urging police reform amid nationwide anti-racism protests. Now, Mr. Biden will face President Donald Trump in elections on the 3rd of November at a White House news conference on Tuesday. Mr. Trump, a Republican, said he was pleased with Mr. Biden's choice, adding she did very, very poorly in her effort to become the Democratic nominee. Ms. Harris will debate Mr. Trump's running mate, Vice President Mike Pence, on the 7th of October in Salt Lake City, Utah. The role of a vice presidential running mate isn't clearly defined. One of the traditional roles is to go on the offensive in exposing the opposition's weakness, while the presidential nominee focuses on communicating the party's message, says the BBC North American reporter Anthony Zucker. So what is she going to be doing? Will she be able to bring the support from the blacks and the minorities on board for the Democrat or for Joe Biden? And is it going to actually change the fortunes for them, or is it going to work against them? I want to know all this, more of that on Star Radio, okay? Your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. So moving on to some other stories making the rounds in other parts of the world. Now, Mexican ex-leader Peña Nieto has been accused of corruption, and then French NGO worker shot dead in Guatemala. Trinidad and Tobago governing party claims victory. Okay, as for the victory, people continue to claim it. The decade of downfall for the okay, let me just leave that story. It's a sad one there, but I'll just leave it. Now, prosecutors in Mexico have opened a corruption investigation against former President Enrique Peña Nieto. It comes after Emilio Lozoya, the ex-head of state energy firm, accused Mr. Peña Nieto of taking millions of dollars in bribes and billions and bribing MPs. My apologies. Mr. Lozoya was extradited from Spain last month to stand trial on corruption charges linked to Brazil's construction giant Odebrecht. Now, Mr. Peña Nieto was in office in 2012 to 2018, has so far made no comment. Now, last year, a witness testifying at the U.S. trial of Mexico drug cartel kingpin Joaquin El Chapo Guzman said Mr. Peña Nieto had accepted $100 million bribe from the mobster. The ex-president also made no comments on that allegation, but he has previously rejected allegation of corruption. Everybody rejects allegation of corruption, and he has done so as well. It is Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. Bringing the time now to 7 minutes to the top of the hour. Don't you go away. Now, moving on to some final stories before or the African continent before we bring the program to a close. Namibia has rejected Germany's reparation offer. Let me bring that story. Why has Namibians turned down the genocide reparation offer. Namibia's president, Hage Geingob, has said the offer for reparation made by Germany for mass killings in its then colony was not acceptable. Now, German troops killed tens of thousands of Herero and Nama people between 1904 and 1908 in response to an anti-colonial uprising. It is thought that 75% of the Herero population and half of the Nama population died. The two countries started negotiations over reparation in 2015 and have so far held 8 rounds of talks. Now, President Geingob was on Tuesday briefed about the negotiations by the Namibian negotiation team led by Special Envoy Zed Ingaviru. Okay, the current offer for reparation made by the German government remains an outstanding issue and is not acceptable to the Namibian government, the president said in a statement. No details of the offer were given in the statement. However, the Namibian reports that an offer of 10 million euros was rejected earlier this year. In June, Germany agreed to apologize in principle, but is yet to formally do so. The Namibian president's statement appears to indicate the wording has been a sticking point. While the Namibian government agreed to negotiate the issue of redress, that's reparation, which the German government consistently referred to as healing the wounds, Germany had declined to accept the term reparation, it said. But if you give people who have been killed at a time, killing almost 3/4 of them and half of some others, and you say that, well, you're going to give them what, 10 million euros? Gosh, is it for each person who died? Listeners, it is Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. And that is where, if we had a proper body, that is actually representing the continent, like the AU is a proper body, then we would have seen something good coming out from there. But I don't think anything good. So it's just one country trying to negotiate that, and they will always try to twist their arms in there. Now, Liberia's Vice President Jewel Howard Taylor has been flown to Ghana for treatment after developing respiratory complications, according to a press statement from her office. Mrs. Taylor left the country on Tuesday afternoon following a 4-day stay at a private clinic in the capital, Monrovia. Now, doctors at the clinic recommended her transfer after she had been stabilized, her office said. It denied media reports linking her complications to COVID-19, that's respiratory disease caused by coronavirus. Liberia's weak healthcare system, following a civil war that ended 17 years ago, has seen government officials and the rich routinely travel abroad for medical attention. The vice president's transfer to Ghana prompted an avalanche of calls to radio talk show in Monrovia on Wednesday, with many people expressing frustration over the poor healthcare system. Mrs. Taylor, 56, is an ex-wife of jailed former Liberian president Charles Taylor. She became the vice president to ex-footballer George Weah in 2018 under a coalition arrangement. She has often complained of not being treated like second in command. Well, we wish her a speedy recovery, and we hope that it's not COVID-19 though, because what respiratory disease? Well, let me rest my case. Now, on the final story, Somali American Minnesota Representative Ian Omar has won the Democratic primaries in the USA. That spoken critic of US President Donald Trump fended off primary challenger Anton Melton Mitt on Tuesday. The lawyer had raised millions of dollars for her campaign to challenge her. After her primary victory, she tweeted that organized people will always beat organized money. Star Radio UK, your favorite African and Caribbean radio station in London. Now, finally, in Kenya, health officials in Kenya have said they will engage Russia over its COVID-19 vaccine. This is after Russia became the first country in the world to officially register its vaccine. But experts have raised concerns about the speed of Russia's work, suggesting that researchers might be cutting corners. We definitely will plug in and work with Russia to ensure that the vaccine is safe before we use it. Health Chief Administrative Secretary Mercy Mwanga is quoted as telling a media briefing on Tuesday. She said Kenya government will follow protocols through it through its foreign ministry. Kenya has so far confirmed 27,425 coronavirus cases. This is where I bring the first part of the broadcast to a close. We'll take a commercial break and I come back. I'll take you straight to the questions time in Scotland. Stay tuned and don't touch the dial. But remember, this evening, exactly at 6 o'clock or 18 hours BST, Ms. Olaemi Koike will be coming your way with the Niger Voices. Stay tuned and don't go away.
Hi guys, this is your friend Uruj from Sendwave. Sendwave is a money transfer app that is used by people all over the world to send money to their loved ones in Africa. With Sendwave, you can send money to Ghana, Nigeria, Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. And the best part is, Sendwave is absolutely commission-free. Our exchange rates are excellent. You can see for yourself by checking them out on our website. So how do you use Sendwave? Sendwave is an app that you can download onto your phone from the App Store or Google Play Store. The app is free to download. After downloading it, just open the app and enter your name, email, and phone number. That's it. You're good to go. Make sure you use the promo code SR. S for star, R for radio. This promo code will give you £5 free credit to send to Africa on your first transaction. Your money will be delivered to your recipient within seconds. Feel free to call me on 0749-737-647 at any time. I'll be happy to tell you all about Sendwave and help you in any way I can. Remember to use the promo code SR for £5 free credit. Medase.
Hello, lovely listeners. Tune in to The Renewed Show with Charlotte. Make it a date to listen to me this and every Thursday at 5 p.m. on Star Radio UK. Tune in to an hour of power, an hour of encouragement, an hour to inspire you to stay positive and strong in this season. See you there and listen.
Getting onto the property ladder has never been easy until now. Join us this and every Thursday from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. live on the Property Hour show on Star Radio UK, where we talk to mortgage brokers, property developers, estate agents, landlord, tenant, property consultants on how to invest or get into the property business and make money. You can't afford to miss this. The Property Hour show is your best source into the property industry.
Hello, good people. I'm back again, and this time it's about Mama's Choice Fufu Mix. It comes in two flavors and it contains essential minerals and vitamins. It's gluten-free. You can grab one from the nearest Afro-Caribbean shop or the corner shop next to you. Insist it's Mama's Choice. It's certified by both the US and the UK Food Standard Board. Grab one for yourself today. Mama's Choice. We'll baby sa Charlie.
Listen to aunties Mary, Lottie and Regina on the Family Enrichment Programme on Star Radio UK this and every Saturday from 6 to 8pm.
Some people are wicked because don't make it your business going about revealing
people's secrets. Don't be a busybody.
Yeah. And some people.
Today's typical family is under pressure from various directions. Divorce is on the increase. More and more of the Afro-Caribbean youth are taking to crime, etc. The Family Enrichment Program brings together a team of qualified experts to discuss and shed light on how we can make our families better and stronger. It is said the family can do without the society, but the society can't. Listen to the Family Enrichment Program this and every Saturday from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. on Star Radio UK, your favorite Afro-Caribbean radio station in London. Everybody.
Download our app in iTunes and the Google Play Store.
Enter
lockdown, we recognise that young people among us could be vulnerable and subject to abuse. This is why AmaCares, an organisation that advocates against child sexual abuse, is here to assist the vulnerable amongst us. We have lined up an exciting and educative programmes that can be of help to you. Please check out our website on www.amacares.org for updates of programme. Enjoy a live chat with our team members for advice. Our online counsellors are also available to advise you and signpost you to the right governmental departments. You can reach us on 033-01-332415 or email us at info@amacares.org. Confidentiality is key. Thank you.
Tune in to On Point here on Star Radio UK with Empress Regina every Monday at 5 p.m. GMT. Looking forward to your company.
Check me out.
He tells me my energy is making him tired.
Yes!
How do you get the energy to do
that? I've been told that I have a lot of energy, but my goodness, I think today I have met my match, people. I have met my match, Miss Suzanne. Wow, amazing.
One of the things that's the start of the whole of darkness.
So what did that
myself and the world in adjust? And 2019,
forget the proverbial boardroom. Join me, Simone Frazier, on The CEO, the program that gives you the driving seat over your life. Every Tuesday, 8 p.m. only on Star Radio.
Hi everyone, it's your girl BB Clement, the author of How to Go From Employee to Entrepreneur and the host of your weekly business show, BB Means Business, the show where we discuss everything you ever wanted to know about business but you were afraid to ask. How do I start my business? How do I raise the finance? How do I grow my business? Where am I going to find my customers? Join me every Tuesday at 1:30 p.m. on Star Radio UK to get all the information and tips that you need to become a successful entrepreneur and become financially free. Remember, don't let life dictate to you. Rather, put your signature on life.
Hi guys, this is your friend Uruj from Sendwave. Sendwave is a money transfer app that is used by people all over the world to send money to their loved ones in Africa. With Sendwave, you can send money to Ghana, Nigeria, Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. And the best part is, Sendwave is absolutely commission-free. Our exchange rates are excellent. You can see for yourself by checking them out on our website. So how do you use Sendwave? Sendwave is an app that you can download onto your phone from the App Store or Google Play Store. The app is free to download. After downloading it, just open the app and enter your name, email, and phone number. That's it. You're good to go. Make sure you use the promo code SR. S for star, R for radio. This promo code will give you £5 free credit to send to Africa on your first transaction. Your money will be delivered to your recipient within seconds. Feel free to call me on 0749-7377-647 at any time. I'll be happy to tell you all about Sendwave and help you in any way I can. Remember to use the promo code SR for £5 free credit. Medase.
Hello, lovely listeners. Tune in to The Renewed Show with Charlotte. Make it a date to listen to me this and every Thursday at 5 p.m. on Star Radio UK. Tune in to an hour of power, an hour of encouragement, an hour to inspire you to stay positive and strong in this season. See you there and listen.
Air ambulance and a number of no indication of any injuries. We will keep you updated. Almost anywhere, so make sure you're aware. Ireland and Northern Ireland, meanwhile, mainly dry with some sunny spells. Just the odd, relatively light shower there. Central and southern parts of both the UK and Ireland, widespread showers overnight.
The weather, sponsored by Qatar Airways.
Stay with us. Coming up in the next hour, more reaction to the UK plunging into recession and what it means for jobs and businesses across the country. Watching Sky News at midday, the headlines. The UK sinks into the deepest recession in history as the economy slumps by more than 20% between April and June.
Hard times are here. Hundreds of thousands of people have already lost their job, and many more will.
A-level and GCSE students in England will be able to use mock exams to appeal if they aren't happy with their results. A lucky escape, the extraordinary moment a busy hospital was hit by the Beirut explosion. Joe Biden picks Kamala Harris as his running mate, the first black woman on a major presidential ticket in US history.
We're going out.
You're going out?
Yeah, we're having a day out.
Do you, Sunday. Do you live in London?
I do live in London.
And trial by social media. The Met police defend the officers who stopped Labour MP Dawn Butler. Very good afternoon. The economic impact of the COVID pandemic and the resulting lockdown has become clear today. It was obvious that the UK would officially be in recession for the first time in 11 years once today's GDP figures were published. But the scale of the slump means the recession is the worst on record. In the second quarter of this year, that's the 3 months to the end of June, GDP shrank by 20.4%. That follows a fall of 2.2% in the first quarter. And it means that two consecutive quarterly contractions and the UK economy is now in a recession. This morning, the Chancellor, Rishi Sunak, has been speaking to our economics editor, Ed Conway, about those figures.
When we were chatting a few months ago, I said that hard times were coming, and today's numbers show that hard times are here. Hundreds of thousands of people have already lost their job, and many more will. What I would say, though, is difficult decisions do lie ahead for all of us, but I want to reassure people that we will get through this, and nobody will be left without hope and opportunity.
Why do you think it is that the UK has been so badly hit? I mean, you know, the deepest recession of pretty much any G7 economy.
Yeah, I think that's a very fair question to ask. And as I look at it, I think, you know, the primary explanation is the composition of our economy. Social activities, for example, going out for a meal, going to the cinema, shopping, those kinds of things comprise a much larger share of our economy than they do for most of our European comparator countries. So in a situation where you've literally shut down all those industries for almost 3 months, a long period of time, it is unfortunately going to have an outsized impact on our economy.
When you look at the numbers that we've just seen, you know, 20.4% in terms of the fall in GDP, was that just a price worth paying for keeping the disease under control?
I think we took the decisions that we did at the time we did in order to protect people's lives and suppress the spread of the virus, and those were the right decisions, but it is also now right, given the progress we've made, to have safely reopened our economy. It's not a sustainable situation to have vast swathes of our economy essentially shut down, and that's why we have been able to successfully reopen bits and do it in a safe way. And as people get back to going shopping or going out for a meal or indeed getting back to their office, they will see that it's a new normal, it's a safe normal. We have made changes, guidance is there to ensure that safety.
And they shouldn't be too nervous about the virus, should they?
No, I think as people will see as they go out, whether it's to a shop, whether it's to a restaurant, or whether it indeed is back to their office, I think they will see changes, and those changes are quite tangible, and people should take confidence from those changes to know that this is now a new, safer environment for me to go and do all those things. And that's good news. I think we need to get the economy going. We've talked about jobs earlier in this interview, and we want to try and protect as many jobs as possible. That comes from as much of our economy returning to normal as possible, and that's why we're so focused on these things.
Well, that was the Chancellor speaking to our economics editor, Ed Conway, who's also been looking in more detail at the data.
As the Chancellor was pointing out, these are clearly very unprecedented numbers. You know, we've never seen a contraction of the economy that's been anything like as deep as what we're going through at the moment. And most of that is bad news, but there is actually a bit of good news about how unusual this is. But it's worth just, first of all, looking at the scale of what we're talking about. And if we just can show you a chart of GDP going back over the course of the last few quarters, and you can see there an extraordinary fall in economic activity. And remember, what we're talking about here is the amount of income we're generating across the economy that's just divided between all of us. So this really does matter. This is the sum total of everything that is bought and sold in this country, and it's gone down enormously. And that won't come as a surprise given the nature of the lockdown, but nonetheless, it is striking to see. And if you compare the UK with other countries around the world, you get a similar picture as well. It's a bigger fall in the UK. There you can see the red bar there. A bigger fall in the UK than almost any other country, apart from Spain, which had a similarly intense lockdown and a similar spate of the disease around the same kind of time, but bigger in the UK in terms of the contraction than in France, in Italy, in Germany, or indeed in the US. And there are other countries in the G7 which have yet to report their numbers, for instance Japan and Canada, but the expectation is they will be a smaller contraction than we've seen in the UK. But as I say, this is striking. These numbers are certainly unprecedented. They aren't necessarily a surprise, though, and many economists thought there was there's going to be a very deep contraction, perhaps even deeper than what we've seen in the event. And there's two pieces of good news perhaps to cling to. The first is that there is a bit of a bounce back that we're seeing if you delve into those numbers and look at the numbers specifically for June, up by about 8.7% in that month. That means the economy is getting back to where it was before the crisis, but it's still a very long way short of where it was, about 17 and a bit percent short of where it was. But the second bit of good news is, obviously, this is unlike any other recession in terms of the scale, but it's unlike it in terms of the nature. This wasn't just a recession that came from elsewhere that was thrust upon the government. The government helped impose this recession with the lockdown. That was part of the answer to trying to deal with COVID-19 as far as the government's concerned. And their point is, now the lockdown's been eased, we should see a quick bounce back. And indeed, this could well be the shortest recession in British history. It may also turn out to be the deepest.
Let's go to Westminster, speak to our political correspondent, Kate McCann. Given we knew this was coming, Kate, how have people reacted?
Well, the political reaction so far has been perhaps as you would expect it to be. Labour saying that Boris Johnson is to blame for the worst death rate and now the worst recession too. Basically saying that the Prime Minister should have made decisions more quickly, made better decisions to avoid the impact that coronavirus is now having on the UK economy. Now, as you heard Ed saying there, there are some points of positivity to look for, and also some suggestions that perhaps because the UK locked down during this period, it was always going to be worse when these figures came out. But the wider political implications for the Conservatives are pretty massive when you think about it. They are doing everything they can, Rishi Sunak, the Chancellor, pumping huge amounts of money into the economy, trying to shore up jobs. But as we move into winter, with the potential of a second peak of this virus, there are some really significant concerns about the number of people who might lose their jobs and that rate of unemployment rising higher and higher and higher as the furlough scheme comes to an end. Now, in terms of the Conservatives' record, as we know, they tend to make a big play of the fact that Conservatives are fiscally responsible, they're very good at looking after the purse strings. Now, there are lots of criticisms too of that, but over the last couple of years, the Conservative Party has said that it has done very well on unemployment figures, made sure that lots of people do have jobs. So Labour are now using this as an attack line, and it's something that may well dog them for the next couple of years if, as Ed says, this recession is very deep and the economy doesn't recover quickly.
Kate, thank you. Let's update you on what's happening in Scotland. A short time ago, we told you that a train had derailed near Stonehaven in Aberdeenshire. We're not getting any information at the moment on any casualties or injuries, but the First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, has tweeted in the last few minutes to say this is an extremely serious incident. I have had an initial report from Network Rail and the emergency services and am being kept updated. All my thoughts are with those involved. She is due in about 5 or 10 minutes' time to give her daily coronavirus news briefing. And I'm sure, given that she's just tweeted about this incident of a train derailing near Stonehaven, that we might hear more, which you'll see live here on Sky News. Sorry, First Minister's questions we're going to be hearing in a few minutes' time. So do stay with us to get more information from the First Minister. But what we do know is that the British Transport Police are responding to this incident. Paramedics are there, 6 ambulances, an air ambulance, and the police as well. ScotRail, the operator on that line, are also assisting with the emergency services. They're all saying they'll provide more information when available. What we don't know at the moment, as I said, is any information on injuries, but you will, of course, hear about it when we know here on Sky News. GCSE and A-level students in England will now be able to use mock exam grades to appeal if they're not happy with the grades they get. The move comes after the Scottish Government reversed its decision to downgrade more than 120,000 moderated results, as Sky's Inzamam Rashid reports.
For A-level students in England, a lifeline from the government.
Big relief, because I did really well in my mocks. I got 3 A's.
A lot of stress kind of went off my shoulders immediately.
It gives you another option, in a sense. It gives you more of a sense of confidence.
Tomorrow, thousands up and down the country will find out their results in what has been an unusual and difficult year. But it all comes down to an algorithm calculating results for them. In Scotland, it's failed, downgrading 125,000 results. It's forced their government to replace them with original scores. In England, the government is now offering a way out. Students will be able to keep their grades from mock exams if they are higher than the calculated ones, and they will have the option to resit exams in the autumn if they're unhappy with their mock exam results or their grades tomorrow. Jesse, Yaya and Leo are all waiting for their results.
Whether they're worse, they're better, I've got grades that I'm proud of anyway. And so it's a big sense of relief for me that I will hopefully be going to the uni of my choice regardless.
I'm much more satisfied because I feel that before, when they said it was just based on the calculated grade, we didn't have much of an option if we did fail or if we did have to go through clearing or if we did get bad grades. Because it seemed like if an appeal had to go through, it had to go through with the school, and we know how long that sort of process would take. So I think referring back to your own piece of work is definitely, it definitely gives a student more of an option. It definitely gives us more like relief, I think.
This 11th hour change to the system will come as a relief to many, but students like Leo say there are still concerns.
I'm just more confused. I think before I was angry because I thought that this system was unfair and it was a broken system, but now I'm just confused because I just don't think mock grades are the right way to go because they're not standardised. So that means there's going to be so many inter-school differences.
For many, these results will play a vital role in university and job prospects, and this triple lock from the government does give students options. But it's come late, and it's still unclear how this new measure will be implemented fairly across the country. Inzamam Rashid, Sky News.
Let's talk now to Joe Grady, the General Secretary of the University and College Union. Joe, welcome to you. Thanks for speaking to us today. How has this late change changed things for you when tomorrow arrives?
I think this is a really unfortunate 11th hour change. You know, the chaotic nature of this announcement means that actually the reality of the government new system is only starting to filter through. I think some of the student voices that you've just heard are actually going to be disappointed because it's not going to be a case of simply being able to choose their mock result as initially briefed. You know, they're going to have to get their school to mount an appeal. There's currently isn't an individual right for a student to appeal. Many educational professionals was saying that this problem was going to happen when the first proposals were put forward. We've seen what's happened in Scotland. Scotland have said, okay, we need to step back. And I think the Westminster government needs to do the same.
Someone we spoke to a short time ago who was a deputy head at a school that will be getting its results tomorrow was saying, whatever is decided is going to be imperfect. This is an unprecedented situation. I mean, in your view, what could be done better, or is it going to be a case of whatever happens, someone's losing out?
It was always going to be imperfect, but I think what we need to do is make sure that the solution is as fair as possible. And what we know is that disadvantaged students have already been disproportionately hit by COVID. You know, they've had less access to Wi-Fi and other types of resources. And relying on a school's past performance and now relying on a student having to launch an appeal against this isn't perfect and it isn't fair. I think we can admit this was going to be difficult, but I do think the government has to acknowledge that they got it wrong, and they need to look at what Scotland have done to simplify the system and ensure that they particularly put students first and those who have been most disadvantaged and hardest hit by this decision.
So you would advocate a mirroring of what the Scottish government have done, which is to basically base it on the teachers' predictions?
I think at the moment that is the fairest way forward, but I think there has to be a broader conversation, and UCU have been campaigning this for many years, that predictive grades are far from ideal, you know, but that's what we have at the minute. Going forward, we need a system that actually moves to applications once grades have been confirmed.
What do you think it's going to do for university applications and university places? Because we now suddenly have a situation where Scotland, England, Wales and Northern Ireland, everyone's getting their results in a slightly different way. Universities being asked to be lenient, maybe wait a week before diving into offering places. What's it going to do for that system?
I mean, let's be honest, staff will be having a complete nightmare in universities right now. There will be staff all around the UK that have been preparing for today, running mock clearing sessions, and everything's just been thrown up in the air. And the government are saying that there's clarity through this and people being able to choose, but it's just not that simple. And universities are already in crisis because the government hasn't stepped in to underwrite the sector. So they need to know how many students are coming. They need to know so they can prepare. Staff need to know what they're doing so that they can get their modules ready. And all of this happening weeks before the government thinks that face-to-face teaching on campus should resume.
Do you expect, the government have said this is it, the decision is made, do you anticipate that will still be the case this time tomorrow or in a few days?
I mean, I really hope not. I think that it's incredibly clear that this is, ad hoc, that this has been done incredibly rushed. And I really hope that they have the courage to admit that this is flawed, admit that it was wrong, listen to the professionals who were warning them about the pitfalls of this from the beginning, and actually step in and give the leadership and the certainty and the clarity to staff and students that we all deserve.
And just finally, Nick Gibb, the schools minister this morning, said that actually largely this will affect, and he said help, the minority of students. Is that still true, that people who are affected by this tomorrow will be in the minority and most students should be unaffected and get the grades they think they deserve?
I mean, you can't say for certain, but if we look at the mess in Scotland, 124,000 exams were downgraded. That's a lot. And on average, the pass rates for pupils in deprived areas went down by 15.2% compared to just 6.9% in the affluent areas. So I'm not really convinced by those claims.
Jo, thank you very much for your time. Appreciate it. More now on this ongoing incident in Stonehaven, near Stonehaven in Aberdeenshire in Scotland. Emergency services are at the scene of a train derailment near Stonehaven. It's on the east coast of Scotland, being described as an extremely serious incident by the First Minister. Let's speak to Adele Robinson. Adele, we're trying to get some pictures of this to show people, but the pictures I'm looking at, a huge amount of smoke billowing from the countryside. What more do we actually know right now?
Well, there's little detail around at the moment. We know that British Transport Police are investigating, as they put it, an incident on the line near to Stonehaven. They say they were called at 9:43 a.m. this morning. Stonehaven is a town in Aberdeenshire on the northeast coast of Scotland. And the reports that this is a derailed train, you can see from some of the images online that smoke is billowing from where presumably the train is along the line, near to some trees. And it looks like a major emergency response is underway. Fire brigades, ambulance crews and police officers on the scene. At least it's reported 30 emergency vehicles, including the air ambulance as well, with more arriving. We've had a tweet within the last few minutes from the Transport Secretary, Grant Shapps. This is what he said. Just met urgently with Network Rail for a briefing on Stonehaven derailment. British Transport Police and Network Rail are on location, along with rail workers who were nearby. The UK government will provide every support. My thoughts are with those involved and their families. Now, it's worth saying that, to put this into some context, potentially, there has been some extremely bad weather across Scotland overnight, torrential rain and thunderstorms and flooding and a lot of travel disruption too across central and eastern Scotland. In fact, last night there was severe flooding, including in the town of Stonehaven, where some homes and businesses were left knee-deep in water. Nicola Sturgeon has also tweeted, this is what she said within the last 10 minutes, "This is an extremely serious incident. I've had an initial report from Network Rail and the emergency services, and I'm being kept updated. All my thoughts are with those involved." Another tweet as well from a local MP in Scotland, Andrew Bowie, who said, "Just off the phone with the Secretary of State for Transport, Grant Shapps, regarding the train derailment south of Stonehaven, who's spoken to and is liaising with ScotRail and Network Rail. Emergency services are at the scene. Thoughts are with every single person involved." So as I said, little detail coming out as yet as to whether or not there has been any injuries. We'll keep you updated.
Adele, do stay with us. We're just hearing from the Press Association news agency, and I must stress that these are unconfirmed reports that they are citing, that at least one person has died after this train derailment that Adele was talking about near Stonehaven. That is unconfirmed. and it's been mentioned to the Press Association news agency. So we're obviously chasing confirmation of that, and we'll bring you any news we get with regards to it. But Adele, as you were saying, I mean, pictures, even this morning, I was waking up to pictures on Twitter of huge amounts of rain, water, flooding in parts of Scotland. And while we do not know if that is related to what's happened, it's certainly something to consider.
Yes, that's right. As I mentioned, particularly travel disruption and the hazards that can be brought about as a result of flood water on train lines. We've seen it in the past, in the last few years, particularly along the south coast of England. In the southwest, there was that train line that was washed away. That was after a sustained period, though, of bad weather. This has been less so, a less sustained period of bad weather is what I mean. You know, we've seen torrential rain, as I mentioned, and thunderstorms, but this has all happened, it would appear, very quickly. There are some other reports, again, unconfirmed, as you said, that at least one person has been killed and perhaps several injured in the train derailment, and also talk of a possible bridge collapse as well at Carmont near Stonehaven. But again, all of this unconfirmed at this stage.
Yeah, we're waiting in a few minutes' time to take you to Holyrood. It's First Minister's questions today. And the fact that Nicola Sturgeon, as Adele has mentioned, tweeted about this being an extremely serious incident, we anticipate she may well say something in First Minister's questions. We'll keep an ear on that and let you know if she does, and you'll see it here live on Sky News. This line operated by ScotRail, it's obviously the line up to Aberdeen that will pass through Stonehaven, and this incident taking place just outside near to Stonehaven. Let's go to Holyrood and hear from the First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I give an update on coronavirus, I do want to briefly address the impact of serious storms across Scotland last night. There has been significant travel disruption, and efforts are underway across the country to restore services and roads to normal. However, of most urgent concern is an extremely serious incident on the rail line west of Stonehaven, where a ScotRail passenger train derailed earlier this morning. The emergency services are currently on site and a major incident has been declared. I have just come off a call with Network Rail and the emergency services, and although details are still emerging, I am afraid to say that there are early reports of serious injuries. The Scottish Government Resilience Room is operational, and I will be convening a SCORE meeting with partner organisations as soon as possible this afternoon. Updates will, of course, be provided as they become available. However, my immediate thoughts, and I'm sure the thoughts of everyone across the chamber, are with all those involved in this incident. Let me turn now to the daily update on COVID. An additional 47 positive cases were confirmed yesterday. That represents 1% of the people who were newly tested yesterday and takes the total number of cases now to 19,126. A full health board breakdown will be available later, but my provisional information is that 24 of the 47 new cases are in the Grampian health board area. It's not yet clear how many are connected to the ongoing outbreak in Aberdeen, and I'll say a bit more about that just shortly. A total of 265 patients are currently in hospital with confirmed COVID, which is 4 fewer than yesterday. 3 people are in intensive care, which is the same as yesterday. I'm also pleased to say that yet again, in the past 24 hours, no deaths were registered of patients who tested positive over the previous 28 days. So the number of deaths recorded under that measurement remains 2,491. National Records of Scotland has, however, just published its more comprehensive weekly report. This includes deaths of people confirmed through a test as having COVID, as our daily figures do, but also deaths of people where COVID is a presumed factor. The latest NRS report covers the period to Sunday, the 9th of August. It records the total number of registered deaths with either a confirmed or a presumed link to COVID as 4,213. Of those, 5 were registered in the 7 days up to Sunday. That is a decrease of 2 from the week before and is the lowest weekly figure since the outbreak began. That said, every single loss of life is a source of grief and heartbreak, and my condolences again go to everybody who has lost a loved one. The NRS figures, however, do reinforce the point that COVID has, as of now, been driven to very low levels in Scotland. That is what has allowed us to take significant steps out of lockdown over July and August, and of course it's the reason schools are able to reopen this week. I know that many children today will be having their first day back for 5 months, and I wish them well and want to thank all teachers and school staff for all the work they have done, as well as thank parents for their efforts in supporting their children in these unusual times. Schools are going back because we've been successful in reducing COVID rates in the community, but there is no room for complacency. Today's figures show that we are still seeing new cases, and the ongoing cluster in Aberdeen shows that the virus can spread rapidly when it gets the opportunity. On the latest figures available, a total of 272 cases have been identified in the Grampian Health Board area since the 26th of July. As of now, 177 of these are thought to be associated with the cluster linked to Aberdeen pubs, and 940 contacts have now been identified from those 177 cases. In general, in the last few days, we've seen a slight fall in the number of new cases in Grampian and in those directly associated with the cluster. But despite this slight reduction, cases are still far higher than in any other part of the country and considerably higher than they were in Grampian before the outbreak started. So based on an assessment from the incident management team and advice from the Chief Medical Officer, the Scottish Government's conclusion is that it is not yet possible to lift any of the restrictions that were put in place last week for Aberdeen. Aberdeen City Council have been fully involved in these discussions, as have Police Scotland, who report good compliance with the restrictions. So if you live in Aberdeen, you should not go into someone else's house. Hospitality businesses such as pubs, restaurants and cafes must remain closed for now. And people who live in Aberdeen should not travel more than 5 miles unless they have to. You can travel for work or education, but you should not travel for leisure or other non-essential purposes. Similarly, we're advising people from outside Aberdeen not to travel into the city unless they have to. I know people in Aberdeen who, of course, are today coping with the impacts of severe weather as well as COVID will be disappointed by this decision, but I want to thank them for complying so well with the rules that we put in place last week. We continue to watch closely for any signs that the outbreak has spread to Aberdeen Shire in any significant way, but at present we are not placing any additional restrictions on people living in the Shire. And I want to stress that nobody wants these restrictions to be in place for longer than is necessary. They will be reviewed again in 1 week's time, and as soon as we can relax any of them, we will do so. But at the moment, the number of new cases we are seeing is still too high for that to be a safe or a sensible course of action. Final thing I want to highlight in relation to the Aberdeen outbreak is that the significant majority of contacts identified are currently being traced within a day, and all contacts are being traced within 3 days. That is a real credit to the work of our test and protect teams, including people from outside Grampian who have been helping with the work in Aberdeen, and I'm grateful to all of them. To conclude, Presiding Officer, Aberdeen reminds us how quickly this virus can take off and how much effort is then required to bring outbreaks under control. It therefore reminds us that for the country as a whole to make further progress out of lockdown, we must continue to suppress it. Government has a critical, indeed the central role to play in achieving that, but ultimately we're all dependent on each other. It will be the choices all of us make as individuals on physical distancing, face masks, on washing our hands, that will decide whether we move forwards or backwards in our fight against COVID. So let me close by emphasising again the importance of facts, the five key things all of us must do. Face coverings in enclosed spaces, avoid crowded places, clean hands and hard surfaces regularly. 2 metre distancing remains the rule, and self-isolate and book a test if you have symptoms. These are the golden rules which can help us to stop the spread of this virus, and I ask everyone across Scotland to continue to comply fully with them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, First Minister. Before we turn to questions, just to remind members, most questions, not all, but most questions have been on COVID, therefore supplementary questions. Therefore, I'm going to continue to take all supplementary questions, constituency and otherwise, after question 7, all of them after question 7. However, if you wish to ask a supplementary, press your button as soon as possible. Turn now to question 1, Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. May I add the thoughts of my party to those already expressed regarding the incident in Stonehaven today? It is clear that this incident is serious and it will have affected a number of families across Scotland. We think of them at this time and also those emergency workers who are currently in attendance. Presiding Officer, the last week has been a terrible time for Scotland school pupils and a new low for this government's handling of our education system. Yesterday, the Education Secretary sought to draw a line under events.
We'll leave proceedings in Holyrood there for the moment and return you to the information that we learned there from the First Minister about this train derailment just west of Stonehaven in Aberdeenshire. Adele Robinson is in our newsroom and has been keeping track. What more did we learn in the last few minutes from the First Minister that we didn't know, Adele?
Well, she mentioned significant travel disruption at the very beginning of that meeting, and she obviously mentioned the West Stonehaven train derailment. She said that, well, she described it as a major incident and said that there are early reports of serious injuries. She did point out that details are still emerging and that her thoughts are with all involved. We've also just heard within the last few minutes from the Scottish Ambulance Service. A spokesman has said that they currently have multiple resources in attendance at a train derailment near Stonehaven, including six ambulances, our special operations response teams, air ambulance, patient transport vehicles, and the ScotStar Emergency Services. More information will follow when we have it. You can see those pictures there, the smoke billowing out from what appears to be the line, and also some of the photos on social media show a field just in front of that with a large number of emergency services vehicles there, at least 30 it's reported, with more arriving. Major emergency response, clearly. As I said, Nicola Sturgeon talking about significant travel disruption in that area. We've seen overnight torrential rain and thunderstorms across central and eastern Scotland with much flooding. In fact, overnight there was severe flooding in this particular area. It's been reported in Stonehaven. Some homes and businesses were reportedly left knee-deep in water. British Transport Police say that they are responding to the incident on the line, and of course they'll be working alongside police, ambulance and fire crews also in attendance.
Adele, thanks. And yes, as you were saying, these are the first pictures you will have seen if you've been watching Sky News of what's happening there near Stonehaven, and huge number of emergency services clearly reflecting the fact that this is an extremely serious incident, as the First Minister of Scotland, Nicola Sturgeon, has outlined in Holyrood today. Just run through a few other key people who have been talking about this. Andrew Bowie, the MP for West Aberdeenshire and Kincardine, has spoken to Grant Shapps, who's the Transport Secretary and is liaising with ScotRail and Network Rail. Thoughts with every person involved, he said, and basically everyone, emergency services, politicians, saying that they will update us, the public, with more when they can do it. Let's have a look at what the First Minister had to say as well on social media just before she would have started First Minister's questions. Here is her tweet. It's an extremely serious incident. I've had an initial report from Network Rail, the emergency services, and I'm being kept updated. All my thoughts are with those involved, and indeed the leader, Ruth Davidson, in Holyrood as well, Conservative MSP, echoed those thoughts as well when she was replying to the First Minister a short time ago. And we know that it was a ScotRail passenger train. The other thing that Nicola Sturgeon was mentioning in her addressed to the Scottish Parliament a bit earlier was the fact that Grampian and Aberdeen itself has been subject to greater restrictions around COVID-19, and whether that might have meant this particular train was far emptier than it would otherwise normally have been, we don't know, but she did say there are reports of serious injuries at the moment, and we are awaiting some more detail from both the emergency services, the First Minister, and politicians. Adele, the weather in these photos, obviously it's a beautiful day there in Scotland at the moment, but some of the photos I'm sure you've seen and did mention previously as well have shown a huge amount of rain on some of the rail lines across Scotland.
Yes, that's right. You know, you look at these photographs and it's hard to believe that there has been torrential rain and thunderstorms and such severe weather overnight, actually, and into this morning. Flash flooding, it's been reported. And as I said, across central and much of eastern Scotland, Stonehaven is a town in Aberdeenshire, which is on the northeast coast. So it would have been potentially hit pretty hard by that bad weather coming in overnight. In fact, there are reports that Stonehaven itself was submitted to some pretty severe flooding, and that some homes and businesses were left, as one person described it, knee-deep in water. These things can happen very quickly in terms of the amount of rain coming down and any impact it has. It can be difficult to discover this until perhaps it's too late. But of course, it's early. We're in the early stages. We don't know why this happened. You would assume that it would be weather dependent, but we simply don't know.
Yeah, absolutely. Just getting a few bits more information in as time goes by. According to the internet forum Rail UK, which I believe is for rail enthusiasts, train spotters and people who know a lot about the rail system across the UK, we're hearing that the train involved in this incident may have been the 6:38 a.m. departure from Aberdeen going to Glasgow Queen Street, and it would have called at Stonehaven at 6:53 a.m. this morning. And let's quickly hear what the First Minister had to say in Holyrood a few moments ago.
Briefly address the impact of serious storms across Scotland last night. There has been significant travel disruption, and efforts are underway across the country to restore services and roads to normal. However, of most urgent concern is an extremely serious incident on the rail line west of Stonehaven, where a ScotRail passenger train derailed earlier this morning. The emergency services are currently on site, and a major incident has been declared. Details are still emerging. I am afraid to say that there are early reports of serious injuries. The Scottish Government Resilience Room is operational, and I will be convening a SCORE meeting with partner organisations as soon as possible this afternoon. Updates will, of course, be provided as they become available.
We can speak on, I thought you were on the phone there, Mark, apologies, but we can see Mark White, our Home Affairs correspondent. Now, Mark, you yourself know this area very well. You may even have, I mean, I've certainly travelled on that train line that we believe the train was on myself as well. Tell us a little bit about the area, how busy that train might have been in normal times or affected by COVID.
Yes, indeed. Well, I worked up in Aberdeen for 7 years in my early days with ITV Regional News up there, so know the area very well indeed. This is a main line between Aberdeen and Dundee. Of course, there are services going as far south as the south coast of England, but the early indications are that this was a passenger train heading to Glasgow. Likely, I'm sure, to have been a significant number of people on board that train, and really we were waiting for word as to whether this may have been a goods train or a passenger train. Clearly the more worrying element is if it's confirmed that it's a passenger train, and the First Minister did indeed confirm that not only was it a passenger service, but those reports that she's been getting from the emergency service personnel at the scene are of serious injuries. We can tell by the emergency service response at this